G'day and welcome to the Aussie Ideas Man. Let's dive into the third video that the Cretin has started to make on the live stream. I think he's slowed down now. I haven't seen anything past the fourth video in quite a few days. In any case, this one's all about the money. I don't think I'll be saying too much.
All right, so the next part of this video, the live stream was with Blake, who is their main finance guy. I think he's kind of basically taken over the position of CFO, essentially. They don't really have a CFO, but I think he's probably the closest thing they have to a CFO at this point. And it's very clear that he's very busy and they're doing a lot of work. And they have not been kind of rolling their, you know, just kind of in a holding pattern here.
This morning, Chris pitched a bunch of their bankers. I don't know if you guys already talked about that.
Nope.
But yeah, that's what we spent the morning prepping for. Chris doesn't have to do too much prep because he's so used to it. But they had a lot of really interesting questions and some new ones that Chris knocked out of the park. So it's cool to meet their larger team. You know, the U.S. Capital Group, we decided to work with them because they have both reaches, this really kind of focused market, that strategic investment, larger investors, and then they have a really wider network that some of their bankers are going to go out to as well. So we need to educate as many of their bankers as possible. That's what today was for. Thankfully, we have a marketing team that's produced a lot of great material to get them scaled up and kind of understand how the company works. But the cool thing was a lot of them already heard of us and knew about us. So there wasn't too much education on some of the Silicon Valley guys' side.
Yeah, that's great. Cool. Anyone have any questions for Blake? Whatever we can answer.
Yeah, there
are
certain things related to the offering we're still waiting on. They're holding back the final kind of details, but we're hoping those will come as soon as possible. But otherwise, the majority of that raise is kind of locked down, and we're ready to kick it off.
Yep. So that'll be in July, right?
Yep. That starts next week.
Next week.
Cool.
Soft launch next week. In U.S. top hurdles terms, there's a harder, more comprehensive launch that will happen mid-July.
Yeah.
So I'm not really sure what they mean when they say launch. Do they mean that they're going to go pitch it to Youth Capital's, like, kind of private group of large investors? Or do they mean that they're going to pitch it to other banks for, like, debt financing? I'm not sure how that works. If anyone knows how that works, how this like investment bank fundraising works, let me know in the comments below.
Yeah.
Cool. People keep asking, where's your dog?
Where's my dog? It's my wife's dog that I inherited. It's not my dog. But every now and then that dog becomes a pain at home and he has to come hang out here with me. So, yeah.
Cool.
But we love him. Yeah, he's a little poodle terrier mix. He's about this big. So he doesn't... Nobody really notices him here, which is good.
Yeah.
There's a couple dogs running around every now and then. Steve's family dog is here in office every now and then.
Right. People are asking just stuff like the timeline of the raise or when they'll get more info. I guess that's when we get the control number, right? So.
Yeah, the timeline of the raise, it's really going to depend on how the outreach goes. We think it's in the 4 to 8 week range, not for complete close, but to really gauge the interest and see what's going to come in.
Okay, so that's pretty important. 4 to 8 weeks. So that means we're looking at early September to mid to late September before we know what the status of this U.S. capital raise is. Like, is it going to be successful or is it not?
And it's all going to depend on how it comes in. You know, one large investor, a couple smaller investors, or, you know, kind of broken up in pieces. So that'll really determine the timing on how that rolls in.
Right. And then people are asking, when IPO?
The great thing about having Blake on board is he's helped companies become IPO ready.
Yep.
And becoming Sarbanes-Oxley compliant, and just give the whole laundry list of checkboxes that you have to go through to be compliant as a public company and be a regular filer. That's what Blake has great experience with, and now we have Tom on board as our CFO. So we think.
Oh wait, so they do have a CFO, Tom. Who is Tom? We need to find this out.
That we want to talk, we want leverage.
Okay, guys, I looked around and I could not find who Tom, the APTERA CFO, is. So gonna ask around and see if we can figure out who this person is. But that's cool. They got a CFO. I don't know when that happened. They didn't announce it. but it seems like they have one now.
To be able to get more funds into your company to spread your idea, your product, whatever you're doing more quickly. So That's what we hope is we've got a near-term plan that we're focusing on now that gets the vehicle into production at a level around 6,000 a year. And then how do we grow to 100,000 a year? That's when IPO, Department of Energy loan money, equipment financing at a bigger scale. We've been talking to a lot of sovereigns, maybe some of those come into the bigger plan. So that's the hope, but it's kind of a year timeline is an optimistic IPO path. It could be 2 years or longer. There's no guarantees, and it could be somebody loves us, and you know maybe Elon wants to come down and adopt us,
or Apple, or who knows. Yeah,
we see the spy shots of future Tesla vehicles, and we're like, under one of those covers could be an APTERA. You know,
we already made it. Cool. Yeah, people are asking a lot of good questions. I think people are very excited that the Reg CF is coming to a close soon, and we're gonna be starting the next phase, you know?
Yeah.
Okay, this is the part where Blake talks about the 6,000 a year revenue neutral number, and also about the ATVM loan, because a lot of people have been asking about that.
Very happy about your projection, the 6,000 per year break even thing.
Yep.
Can you speak to that?
Yeah, the 6,000 break even is part of the financial model. I don't really think it's gonna, you know, that's not gonna be the target that we're going for. The pre-orders obviously dictate that we're gonna be selling a whole lot more than that.
Yeah.
We were asked to build, you know, a base case, you know, where would we get to that point? A lot of factors go into it. It's gonna be a ton of work to get to that point, but I don't think we're really gonna be working towards that model. Personally, I think we're gonna be more towards the higher volumes, 20,000 and plus, but it's nice to have that out there to show, you know, the investors that ask that question. I know everybody's curious about getting to profitability. We're laser focused on getting to profitability, but we're also laser focused on getting a million APTERA on the road, and 6,000 a year is not,
it's not
really
the
rate. I don't really think about that. I know it's very exciting for people to understand, but I don't think about the 6,000 a year rate too much. I more look at the high volume model that we built.
Right. What are you looking forward to? Like, you know, let's say US capital raise goes great. I mean, we're going to be scaling up, right? Like, it's going to get nuts.
Massive domino effect. If the U.S. capital raise goes the way that we expect it to go, and it finishes up, there's a lot of, you know, supplier agreements and negotiations that'll get locked in. So we'll sign those up. It'll, you know, flatten out what's going on in the model. A lot of things change here and there. A lot of things kind of bounce back and forth. So we'll kind of be able to commit to some things, get it locked down, and what else? Yeah, a little bit of hiring, but like I said, I feel like we've really built an environment here where we can kind of scale up without having to hire too much in my department or too much in the related departments. Really, you know, manufacturing people that we'll be hiring up on.
Yeah,
cool. And working with partners there.
One last question is on the ATVM loan. Is that something that we still want to do in the future?
Yeah, that's another big thing. You know, the U.S. capital funding come in is one of the major gates that we're going to have to get past to start moving forward with that loan a little bit better. There's also other grants and loan opportunities throughout the world that we're going after, and all of that will get into high gear once we're through this first raise.
Banks don't want to give you money when you need money. They only want to give you money when you don't need money. And it's kind of the same thing with the DOE, is that once we're in production and the sky's the limit, they're happy to extend, you know, financing and other options. But, you know, until then, it's much more difficult. It's really a program built for big companies that already have lots of money flowing, and you know, the DOE can come in and assist. So we think it should be catered to advanced technologies that make the country and the world better, but you know, that's not how these programs play out in reality.
Yeah, but we will, you know, there's the ATVM is one of them. There are other throughout the world that are going to be opportunities for non-dilutive funding that will come our way. We just need to focus on those over the next few months.
Right. Can we speak to other SEC filings or not?
Other SEC filings? There won't.
On the stream.
Check our SEC website and you'll see the filings that are out there. That'll give you all the information that you need. We're just making sure that we're lined up in the future to do any kind of fundraising that we need to get past, you know, this launch and scale up phase.
Right.
Yeah, obviously, successful U.S. capital round, moving towards production. We want to have flexibility to be able to raise money the way we want to. And, you know, we're positioning ourselves for that. And then IPO and beyond, and growing to building lots and lots of vehicles according to Blake's wonderful financial model.
Right. Cool. Thank you so much, Blake.
Thank you guys for stopping
by. You get back to work.
Have a good day.
I've had a busy day today. So. Yeah.
All right. Well,
I didn't have anything to say. I'll just leave it to little text boxes across the screen.
Well, I think there's like one more interesting part of this video, and we'll go over that next.
That's all from me. Bye for now. Till who's next? I'm not sure. I can't count his Maxion going broke and getting sued as a part of the live stream. I think he just went away from the theme for now. I'm still hoping he does the in and out run so that I can highlight the truck following them and see what the cretin has to say about that. Bye for now. Stay safe.